ناصر رسوله ومظهر دينه. Oh Zayd, I don't know what's going to happen, but I know one thing, that Allah is not going to abandon us. That's basically what he's saying. I don't know what's going to happen, but I know that Allah will help us. And subhanAllah, look at this point now. There is no Mecca, there is no Ta'if. He is literally camped in the middle of the desert. And he says, I know, that's his tawakkul. There is where tawakkul comes into play. I did everything I could. Now, it's up to Allah. I didn't make fall short in anything. And the Prophet ﷺ then began sending emissaries to two or three allies within Quraysh that he thought might be sympathetic to his call. The first of these was Al-Akhnas ibn Shuraiq. And Al-Akhnas ibn Shuraiq sent a message back saying that I'm not in a position to give you protection. What's happening here, you understand? Banu Hashim has rejected him. Abu Lahab has rejected him. So he doesn't have the visa. He doesn't have protection. He needs to get protection. If the Banu Hashim have rejected him, there are 15 other sub-tribes of the Quraysh. Perhaps one of them might accept. Obviously not the Banu Makhzum. Who's in charge of the Banu Makhzum? Abu Jahl and Al-Walid, right? So he didn't even send, obviously. So of these, basically, how many sub-tribes did the Quraysh have? At least 15, maybe 20. So the Banu Hashim is only one. The Banu Umayyah is another. The Banu Abd al-Shams is another. So the Banu Makhzum is another. So there's around 15 or 20 sub-tribes of the Quraysh. The Prophet ﷺ first sends it to one of the sub-tribes. Response comes back, we're in a weak position. We cannot give it to you. He sends it to Suhail ibn Amr. Suhail ibn Amr is the same one who negotiated the treaty of Hudaybiyah. Suhail ibn Amr. By the way, Al-Akhnas eventually becomes a Muslim. Suhail ibn Amr eventually becomes a Muslim. And this shows us that the Prophet is not sending it to random people. These are people he knows, they sympathize with him. Right? Because they eventually accept Islam. These are people he knows, they're different than Abu Lahab and Al-Walid and Abu Jahl, right? So he sends it to Suhail ibn Amr. Suhail ibn Amr sends back that I am Banu Amir ibn Lu'ay, and Banu Amir ibn Lu'ay have never given protection for somebody from the Banu Ka'b. I don't want to start a precedent. In other words, they both gave flimsy excuses. Both of these are not true excuses. The Prophet knows what he's doing. And if they wanted to, they could have given him protection. Now, in the fact that they give a flimsy excuse, it shows that their animosity is not the same as the animosity of Abu Jahl and others, right? I mean, when do you give a flimsy excuse? When you're embarrassed, correct? When you're embarrassed, when you know you should do something. And so the Prophet knows exactly where he's sending the emissary. So the both of them come back basically with a polite rejection, basically. And then he sends it to the third one, and that is Mut'im ibn Adi. Mut'im ibn Adi, we've come across his name before, and this is basically the last time we're going to come across his name, because he dies very shortly after this. Mut'im ibn Adi is the chieftain of the Banu Nawfal ibn Abd Manaf. The Banu Nawfal, another sub-tribe. The Banu Nawfal ibn Abd Manaf, and he's the only one who died a pagan in this list of three. He's the only one who died a non-Muslim. Who is the Mut'im ibn Adi? Mut'im ibn Adi was the main one who broke the... What did he break? The boycott. He broke the boycott. This is Mut'im ibn Adi. Who is Mut'im ibn Adi? Mut'im ibn Adi is the one who would send camels when they were in that boycott, right? He would send an entire camel. That's like, you know, in our times, $50,000 is a camel. It's a massive amount of money. And the camel has food and drinks and water and stuff. So he's sending another 10,000, 20,000 of good on the camel. This is Mut'im ibn Adi. This is Mut'im ibn Adi. So Mut'im ibn Adi, he is sent a message. The Prophet is saying that, will you give me your ajid, your protection? He knows the whole story, right? And so Mut'im doesn't just send a messenger back. Mut'im tells his sons, he has four sons. Mut'im tells his sons, go arm yourselves, put your armor on, get your weapons, and go and follow the messenger back, and come as armed guards, guarding the Prophet ﷺ, and bring him straight back to me. And so an entourage of the sons of Mut'im ibn Adi went outside of Mecca, all of them dressed to fight. And they came in with the Prophet ﷺ, protected. And Mut'im went to the Kaaba to receive him. And he said to the Prophet ﷺ, do tawaf, I'm waiting for you. Because he knew that the Prophet ﷺ always began everything with tawaf. Do tawaf, I'm waiting for you. So the Prophet ﷺ did tawaf armed. The guard is doing tawaf with him to guard him, right? And then when he finishes, everybody's wondering, what is going on here? Mut'im stands up and he says, O people of Mecca, I have given my protection to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Abu Sufyan stood up and said, are you his follower? Or are you giving protection basically still as a pagan? He didn't say as a pagan, but are you a follower? Or are you just giving a protection? So he said, no, I'm not a follower, I'm just giving protection. Abu Sufyan said, in that case, we shall accept it. Notice, if he had converted to Islam, no. The Quraysh would have rejected it. And in this, there is wisdoms of why certain people did not convert to Islam. And so the Prophet ﷺ remained under the protection of Mut'im for another year and a half, less than 2 years, as we're going to come to, right? But he knows this is a very precarious situation. This is not his immediate tribe. It's not the Banu Hashim. It's a distant cousin. And he remained in the protection of Mut'im, and he kept on figuring out another way, another way, another way, until finally Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala opened for him the door of Medina, and he left surreptitiously in the middle of the night, as we're going to come to, and within a month or two after the hijrah, Mut'im passed away. Mut'im died. And therefore, in the very first encounter, when the Prophet engaged in the Battle of Badr, and 70 plus prisoners of war, 73 prisoners of war were taken hostage, were taken as POWs. The Prophet ﷺ said that one badge of honor that forever remains until the Day of Judgment. لَوْ كَانَ مُطْعِمْ حَيًّا ثُمَّ كَلَّمَنِي فِي هَؤُلَاءِ نَتْنَا لَأَعْطَيْتُهُمْ إِيَّا. If Mut'im had been alive right now, and he just gave me one word, that he wanted all of these natna, these filled, because they're just trying to kill us. He wanted all of these people back, I would have returned them to him, no questions asked. This is a badge of honor, this is a parade, this is a medal given here. The Prophet ﷺ is praising Mut'im, who died a pagan, kafir, mushrik. He's praising him in a manner that hardly any Muslim has ever gotten, right? But he's not praising him religiously, he's praising him politically. And in this, wallahi, so much benefit. Not all non-Muslims are the same. You have non-Muslims, they might be kafir, but they have truth and justice when it comes to political rights, civic duties. They might not believe in the same God as you, but they believe in some type of justice. And this is Mut'im, one of them. Right? And there's no problem in honoring them from a worldly sense. The Prophet ﷺ didn't go pray his janazah. The Prophet ﷺ didn't make dua for him. He drew a line. Look, religion is religion. But there's a civic honor given to him. There's a pride. There's a repaying back of the good that you've given me. And the only way I can repay back is to mention you in a way that until the Day of Judgment, there will be some respect and some